Once upon a time, there was a strong, brave warrior called Donald Trump. The kingdom where he lived was plagued with poverty and corruption. He pledged to bring riches and joy back to this corrupted land. He even built his subjects a brand new ice rink. He would go on a journey from the streets to leading his people from despair, vanquishing all who stood in their way. Roland Barthes was a 20th century French literary theorist and philosopher, famous for his understanding of how myth operated. The 1957 book Mythologies is a collection of Barthes' analysis of French culture in the post-war period. The short articles examine topics as diverse as the militarisation of toys, the Romans in films, detergent adverts, how drinking wine makes you French, and Einstein's brain. The opening chapter of Barthes' Mythologies is titled The World of Wrestling, a world that Trump is, of course, familiar with from his involvement in WWE. Many have argued that Trump treats politics like a wrestling match too. His incendiary, sensationalist, news-grabbing comments and tweets excite his supporters and the press in the moment, just like wrestling. How do we understand this, and how do we counter it? In the late 80s, heroes and villains were clashing in Donald's kingdom. Now becoming a hero of the people himself, he pledged to help the embittered forces of good by providing a battleground for them in the great and glistening Atlantic City. An evil villain had owned the grounds on which the heroes fought, and Trump promised to battle him himself and send him into exile. The hero promised gold for all those that watched. Wrestling, of course, is as much about the drama and excitement of each moment than who wins or loses. Entertainment is about maximising attention at each moment. Barthes wrote that the function of the wrestler is not to win, it's to go exactly through the motions which are expected of him. Like stories, people expect twists, turns, heroes, villains, and climaxes. Each moment must be choreographed for maximum enjoyment. Many psychologists have noted that we're more attuned to accept that which is expected than the truth. We have confirmation biases and are more likely to see patterns than anomalies. And the fundamental wiring of the brain analyses things quickly by whether they're good or bad for us. Rationality comes later, comes after, comes slower. Stories can be simple. Politics never is. For Barthes, wrestling amplifies all of this. The winners win bigly. The losers roll around on the floor in an exaggerated fashion. He writes, "In wrestling, as on the stage in antiquity, one is not ashamed of one's suffering. One knows how to cry. One has a liking for tears." He goes on, as soon as the adversaries are in the ring, the public is overwhelmed with the obviousness of the roles. As in the theatre, each physical type expresses to excess the part which has been assigned to the contestant. But what is it exactly that's being exaggerated? What's being amplified when villains get their just desserts and heroes triumph over adversity, when Trump shaves the evil villain's hair after winning the match? For Barthes, above all, wrestling is meant to be an exaggeration and a caricature of justice. Heroes and villains and wrongdoers getting their dues, shouts of give it to him or make him pay, lock her up, the concept of retribution, an eye for an eye, of justice, it's all central. Because right and wrong, personal morality, is a snap judgment of justice. And politics is right and wrong amplified onto a complicated social stage. Trump's learned all this from wrestling. He knows that indignation can be channeled quickly and powerfully into quick sentences, symbolic moments, stereotypical gestures. Barthes writes that such a precise finality demands that wrestling should be exactly what the public expects of it. Wrestlers who are very experienced know perfectly how to direct the spontaneous episodes of the fight so as to make them conform to the image which the public has of the great legendary themes of its mythology. One day, when our hero was protecting his people and his lands, a dangerous villain took over the kingdom. The villain had pretended he was one of the people, but Trump knew that he was from a dark foreign land. He demanded proof that this fraudulent villain was indeed born in the kingdom, and Trump's people cheered. The last chapter of Mythologies tries to understand how it is that the good and evil narrative exemplified in wrestling works. Barthes argues that myths are simply a form of speech, a certain style, a way of communicating. Anything can be a myth. It's not about the content, but the way it's said. Barthes says that stories have two obvious elements to them. The literal meaning of the sentence. He gives the example of, "My name is Lion." This is literally his name. And the mythic or metaphoric meaning, what Barthes calls metalanguage. "My name is Lion, that I'm dominant, strong, proud, alpha." But Barthes asks an interesting question. Why not just say that I'm strong, proud, alpha? Why the need to hide it underneath the literal meaning somewhat ambiguously? Barthes takes another example, this time slightly more complicated. A young black Frenchman on the cover of a magazine saluting the French flag in the 50s. What's literally signified here? That young black men pledge allegiance to the empire. But myth takes other meanings and incorporates it into the literal one. That the empire is great, it unites all, black or white, that it's not racist. Myth takes from history like a toy box and uses it to do whatever's required in the present. Myth appropriates. Linguistically, the elements in the story have a whole history of meanings, of geography, of values. Each word, lion, flag, is loaded with different interpretations. Me, my name, where I'm from, what I do, and lion, its biology, its environment, its history, its prey, the young black man in France, the uniform, the colonial past, the current objectives of the French government. All of this, ad infinitum, is condensed into the word, the sentence, the photo. Myth takes all of this and empties it, impoverishes it. Everything in it evaporates. Instead, you have a moment. It takes what is necessary for the moment. The young man, Barthes says, is tamed. He becomes an accomplice to French imperialism.
The history of our still young and growing nation is written in every star and fold of our great flag. The great blessing of our birthright is that in this troubled world, there is still a bright spot where borders never change, where peace reigns supreme. The United States of America has become a nation second to none in wealth and influence, in greatness and in power. Our founding fathers sought words to describe the future nation and the flag which typifies it. In the famous preamble to the Constitution, the words "We the People" signify the chain of unity which now welds our vast empire of 48 separate states.
In wrestling, you simply have good versus bad, retribution, backstabbing, justice. He says that to understand what's going on, we must focus on the intention in the moment. Someone wanting to look like a lion has a reason that's nothing to do with the history of lions. French imperialism needing to look inclusive wants to cover up its racism. Myths appropriate history. They transform history into a moment that's meant to look natural. Barthes writes, a conjuring trick has taken place. It's turned reality inside out. It's emptied it of history and has filled it with nature. It's removed the things from their human meaning so as to make them signify a human insignificance. The function of myth is to empty reality. It is literally a ceaseless flowing out, a hemorrhage, or perhaps an evaporation, in short, a perceptible absence. Without an understanding of the history behind the language, the receiver of the myth, the audience, the reader, presumes it to be natural, takes it at face value. For Barthes, understanding the motivation behind this appropriation is key. The hero had almost vanquished the evil imposter, but the villain had a sidekick. the hero knew she was colluding with the enemy within. She was corrupt and couldn't be trusted. Lock her up, he told his followers. The kingdom had turned into a swamp he promised to drain. And once he did, he'd build a great wall to keep his enemies out so that finally his people would be safe. So Trump appropriates entertainment and myth and injects them with tropes of justice and tropes of good versus evil, all for political and personal gain. That much is obvious. If, though, he simplifies everything out and brings entertainment into politics, do his opponents have to follow? I'd argue that an effective political strategy incorporates both, learns these lessons from Barthes. In short, you need both witty, snappy, memorable quotes and in-depth discussion on policy, issues, theory. It's only in this way that you appeal to a broad church of voters required to win elections. Because entertainment is intimately connected to social life, to morality, to politics and ethics, look at how soaps take moral issues and turn them into simplified plots with a couple of twists. In wrestling, kayfabe is the dedication wrestlers have to the big lie, to the idea that it is real, that it's more real than real. And in a sense, the big lie really is true, that life is about story, meaning, entertainment, as much as it is about hard, cold facts. We're biologically programmed to want to listen to and be attracted to the ones that we find superficially appealing, that entertain us. This doesn't mean that nuance doesn't matter. Policy, theory, history, all of it matters, and there's always people who will be interested in long-form political discussions, social studies, and congressional reports, and hopefully more and more people become interested. But most people don't care. It's not that they're ignorant, it's that they have better things to do or are short on time, have lives, struggles, priorities. If exaggeration gets attention in wrestling, the exaggeration of justice, there's no reason why it wouldn't get attention in politics. It's just inevitable. As the journalist Walter Lippman argued, because the political landscape is so vast and complicated, those appealing to voters must condense their messages into symbols. Those symbols, symbols like America, peace, dignity, work, health, whatever they are, must be utilised in such a way and broad enough to incorporate and appeal to the widest possible number. How do you resonate with the person who watches the news for 10 minutes in the evening and that's it? Who sees a flashy headline and that's it? Reads one article or two? By creating simple messages with an emotional appeal. Doing this doesn't stop you going into more detail underneath or following up with more nuance. Trump condenses his politics into the simplest message of all: good versus evil, wrestling, justice. It's messages like this that were central to Brexit, take back control, that were central to Barack Obama's campaign, hope. Bolsheviks won the support of the Russian public with the slogan peace, bread, land. When these are the soundbites that get picked up, get broadcast, sent around the world and stick in the mind, it's inevitable that democratic politics will in some way revolve around them. Again, our brains are wired to remember short, out of the ordinary fragments of information. Democrats would do well to play on this in the upcoming election, to write into the myth a story of deception, a wolf in sheep's clothing, a Judas, a siren, a con man. If you like these videos, I need your help, and here's my request. If you think you get the same value from four of these videos as you do from just one cup of coffee, then please consider pledging just $1 per video. That's $3 to $4 per month to keep this channel going. You can even limit your pledge to $1 a month, and if you pledge $5, I'll add your name to the credits. To those that already support then and now, thank you so much. This channel just wouldn't exist without you. You can also hit like, share, follow me on Twitter and Facebook, etc. All of these things really contribute to helping then and now grow. Thanks for watching and see you next week.